congratulations on everything ASI has been doing over these last years, starting with Barbara's fine work all those years ago. And Barbara continues to keep us on our toes at NHMRC, so we appreciate that as well. As Julia said, I am going to first of all make a few remarks about the situation at NHMRC, and I don't think that's going to do much for your sanity at all, but we might as well be realistic and understand the problem that we face. And I could talk for an hour about that, but I'll just try to talk for a few minutes about the particular issues of gender equity that we're concerned with. And then I'll just talk a little about what I've seen about what may be secrets of success, more learned from watching other people who are successful and regretting that I didn't do those things myself. But I hope perhaps a stimulus to discussion. And I'm really delighted to be sharing this session with Doreen Cantrell. We met as postdocs a long time ago, very long time ago, I'm afraid. And it's really wonderful to see her here at this meeting. So, to start with, NHMRC. And first of all, why should we be worried? Well, first of all, of course, as people here know, NHMRC is Australia's federal funding body for health and medical research, and it's the largest funder and will continue to be for a while until the Medical Research Future Fund eventually matches it. And we're well aware that NHMRC funded researchers, whether they're fellows or supported through various project programs and centre grants, are employed across the whole of the sector, whether it's in medical research institutes or universities or hospitals. It's a very important breadth of people that we must be concerned about. Of course, there's the caretakers of public funds, we have a responsibility to try to use those funds as best we can. And of course, we mustn't waste the talent we have and the investment of the past in women researchers. So I think many people here will be aware that women overall aren't doing as well as men in getting NHMRC grants. And this shows a summary of grant outcomes to date for 2015, and it's not everything because some of them are still being decided and will be announced in a little while, program grants for example. But you can see overall that for all schemes so far, the success rate for women was 16% versus 17.3% for men. So not an enormous difference, but it's something that we have to pay attention to. And the fact that it's like that every year, most years, means that it's not just, I think, statistical variation. We're talking about a very large number of grants. So here's the breakdown for this year so far, and I've just put major schemes in here. There are a few minor ones that have been left out. But the top line is the most important for many people. That's the project grant scheme. It's 50% of the main allocation we get from the federal government every year, so it was $420 million worth of grants in this round. And you can see that the success rate for women here really was noticeably lower at 11.5% than compared with 15% for men, and you'll be aware that it was 13.7% overall. Then the fellowships are very important as well, and so with early career fellowships, we see some bias towards men. We see women having a slight advantage in this round for career development fellowships, which was good news, and then also this year, a higher rate for the more senior research fellowships. But as was apparent from the previous slide, overall, and if you just cast your eyes down those columns, you'll see that women consistently do less well than men on average. Of course, we're aware that there are lots of exceptions to that kind of generalisation, and many of those exceptions, of course, are sitting in this room. Women who are doing extremely well at junior, mid-career and senior levels of the fellowship and other funding schemes, and that includes many women who have families, and so this is not not an entirely bad news story, but we're very worried about the statistics overall. And then this rather horrifying but very informative image from last year's fellowship round showing applications. I'm sorry I don't have the figures for awards last year, but you can see that of applications last year, the number of women applying for early career fellowships was 63%. The number of women applying for senior principal research fellowships, the highest professorial level, was 11%. So women are disappearing, and this is exactly what we all know about, that it happens acutely at that stage of life when people are making decisions about families, but it's probably not only for that reason. We have to be concerned to try to understand all of the factors at play here. If we look across the funding of different research areas, and we ask applicants to tick one of four boxes for their for their applications, you can see that the situation is worst for women as overall proportion of funding received in basic or biomedical science, and it's best in public health and health services research, where women really are the predominant players. And then what's NHMRC doing about this? Well, it's been a concern for quite a few years, but it's really become something that as an agency we've paid a lot of attention to over the last 2 years. And so there's been a lot of work done, but it really has to be continuing work on how to evaluate career disruptions, the time people take out to have children and other sorts of career disruption where they're formally out of the workplace for a while. And also assessment of what's known as relative to opportunity, which tries to take into account the other things that people have happening in their lives which may have an impact on their track records. So this is really difficult space, and when we had a workshop, we've had a couple of workshops on this sort of issue now at NHMRC with quite a few people from the community of researchers, and it's clear that there are a lot of different versions of the story of women going through their careers, and that's one of the things that makes it very difficult to come up with simple, reliable ways of taking into account career disruption and opportunity to develop track records. But we'll continue to work on this, and we're very interested always in people's individual experience and ideas about how we can do this better. And of course, it's not about NHMRC as an office doing this better, it's really about the peer review community doing a good job with this, and therefore us trying as much as possible to put in place policies that people can apply in a systematic way. Our part-time fellowships have been at least an initiative. Better gender balance on peer review panels. Sometimes we hear how unbalanced a panel might be, and so I want to reassure you that we try for every single grant review panel to have roughly equal men and women on those panels, but of course not everybody accepts the invitation, and women will have in many cases more reasons not to be able to accept the invitation, so this can be a challenge, but it's always we're always trying. There's a lot of work being done around the phasing of the whole grant application process through the year to try to avoid the times that would make it extremely difficult for women to write grants or to do their rebuttals or whatever. And this is very, very tough because we are trying to have peer review in the middle of the year. We have a lot of different schemes and they will have to be juggled. And so we're making progress on this, but I know some of those dates are still very, very difficult. The Elizabeth Blackburn Fellowship was introduced to recognise the outstanding, the top career development fellows. There's a Women in Health Science Committee that some people here are on, and it's a very useful source of advice for us. And then perhaps one of the most, ultimately one of the most effective mechanisms might be the new administering institution policy. And this was based on my predecessor, Warwick Anderson, deciding that we needed to do something about this. That we needed to encourage institutions to have policies that would support women and other care people, with males with care responsibilities, to be able to manage those challenges. And so a survey went out in 2013 to all of the institutions, MRIs and universities usually, who can host NHMRC grants. And only 56% of institutions responded, and many of them had less than impressive policies in place. And so NHMRC has been working towards having the institutions have policies in place that might actually work, and we're asking to know what those policies are by early next year. We really, at this stage, want to work in a very positive way with institutions to encourage best behaviour. Now, I won't go through all of this, but it's the list of requirements that are now in the administering institutions policy, and any institution that accepts an NHMRC grant on your behalf does so signing up to all of these things being in place. Importantly, a lot of things there are specifically about women, but extended to other people with caring responsibilities and related issues. And so you may know about the Athena Swan Charter in the UK, and I think I'm not sure whether Doreen is going to say anything about that. I've lost her. There she is. Are you going to say anything about that? So Athena, no. Well, so I think, as I understand it, this is a charter that's been brought in to, again, to work with institutions to make sure they have the right sorts of policies in place, but with the key point, as I understand it, of measuring progress against a whole lot of parameters, and doing that repeatedly over time so that people can get a, institutions get a, can get a bronze, silver or gold badge, if you like, from the Athena Swan Charter. And only, I think, if they have a silver one, it's been mooted, would they be able to have funding from the MRC, if I understand correctly. But
it's actually not.
There's been discussion of doing that, but there's been a lot of pushback as well, and it might not be MRC, so excuse me if I've got that bit wrong, but I hope you'll fill us in some more, Doreen. But Australia is now trialling this approach with quite a number of Australian universities and medical research institutes, and I think that's it's great to see a lot of institutions have signed up to it, and we hope to see progress, which would then match very well with what we're trying to do at NHMRC. So now I want to make a few remarks about what I think might be some of the things that help here. And they're really, I suppose, if I look around at people who've been very successful in their careers, what are the sorts of things that seem to have made a difference? And what are the things that I've understood myself from my own experience and often wish that I had done myself? Perhaps just before going into that list, I just wanted to say a few words about sexism. And the first thing, of course, is that you will inevitably encounter it. You might be encountering it every day, but you will encounter it many times, and it is part of our society, and it affects people in all parts of life, and it's clearly a problem in many professions, not just our own. And I thought it was just an interesting example of that in a workshop I was in last week, and it can be quite subtle, but I'm sure many people have experienced this too. I just noted that we had a room with a number of men and a number of women exchanging ideas about the thing we'd asked them to exchange ideas on. There were men who were very vocal and basically leading the discussion. And mostly women weren't contributing to that discussion. But then right at the end, when it was about to wrap up, two women made two really important points. And the men just barreled on. And it was as though those women hadn't spoken. It was very obvious to me sitting in the corner what had happened, and I brought the discussion back to both of those points because I thought they were extremely valuable. And it seems to me that's the sort of thing that happens that can just not be noticed. And I think it's really important when you see that happening to make sure that women aren't glossed over with their ideas or what they have to say, that, and that it's always important in any kind of meeting to see that everybody has a voice. And that, of course, is not just for women, but for people who have more difficulty speaking up anyway for whatever reason. Can be language reasons, can be natural shyness reasons, but it's just incredibly important, and this was just a version of what we've all seen many times. And a point about that is that it's not only women who face these sorts of issues, and we need to be sensitive to them as women and as men, to those difficulties that anybody might have, but are particularly true for anybody who doesn't fit into the traditional role model of the profession in which you're working. If we see harassment, of course, then we have to call it. We absolutely have to intervene, note it, do something about it. But it's the everyday, just intrinsic biases that are much, much harder to deal with, and I think, again, we have to find ways to manage this and to gradually, each of us as individuals, work against it. And I think that this kind of bias against women as against other groups is everybody's problem, not just women's problem. So back to this long and winding road, and this is a road in Kashmir which I have actually travelled on. It's one of the more frightening experiences of my life. And what you can't tell from looking at this, you can tell from the number of switchbacks that it's steeper than it looks. And so there are lots of opportunities in the long and winding road to fall off the path, and so hang on tight. I think the first thing, this was something a mentor told me very early on in my own career, was to find your big question. And it's, I think, incredibly helpful in thinking about the design of your career to understand what the big question is that you're excited about, which is an important question and that you want to answer. And I think having done that, then something I've seen other people do, I think much more successfully than I have, is to plan projects very carefully. Plan projects and papers well ahead. Now, grant writing is a fantastic help for this, and we should see it as such and try to use the process of grant writing, not as just a desperate attempt to get money, but as a huge opportunity to really think your ideas through, discuss them with people, and make sure you really have planned what you want to do. And I think it's something we can learn. I saw it very clearly when I was director of CRC for vaccine technology, and we were working in a more almost commercial world, and we could see how companies like CSL really project planned in a much more focused way on understanding what the gap was that they wanted to fill and what would be the critical experiment that would tell them whether something was worth developing or not. So there are real lessons for us there. The other one that's really obvious to everyone and so much part of science today is collaboration. And that means traveling, which is a huge difficulty for people with young children. And so if you can't travel, then there have to be other ways to make sure you make those contacts and build those networks. Tell your story, identify the people who you, through these meetings, who you want to work with and who can help you along your way. And I think this is obviously much easier for people who are very outgoing. For a lot of people, it's quite difficult. And for many women, there can be a feeling that it's not their place to do this. But it's clearly critical and has a huge difference in productivity. And I do wonder whether one of the issues we see in looking at lower success rates of women is not just time out, and not just that women are somewhat likely to be younger than older, as we see from the fellowship data, in applying for grants and therefore have less developed track records, but perhaps also are less engaged in sort of big collaborative networks that will really boost CVs. A very important message from a number of people I've met over time is the importance of generosity as a collaborator, as an advisor, whatever role you're playing. You've got nothing to lose really, maybe a little bit of time, but a huge amount to gain by generosity. This is how one builds up the long-term friendships and networks that will help you through the more difficult times. I think another thing that people can benefit from is learning how to give good talks. Talks are all about advertising what you do, and it's something that's worth the effort of preparing a presentation much better than I've prepared this one today, and to get feedback on your talks, because they are your big marketing event at a conference. And so posters, talks, whatever the opportunity is, this is a really important way to boost your profile. Likewise, when you're writing grant applications, you must get other people to read them and to give you feedback, and please give people time to do that. It's unfair to ask people a week before the deadline to read a complex grant and give you feedback in time for you actually to do anything about it. Good people will probably be being asked to read many grants, and so it's really worth planning ahead so that you can get that advice. It can make all the difference to the final product and therefore to your chance of success. Do offer to serve as an external assessor and on grant review panels, because you learn so much from this process. You learn what a grant panel looks for. You learn how to look at work that's well outside your own area, and you just learn about the whole process and how to write a better grant. It's also a very good way of getting networked. And when you're going for an interview, whether it's for a fellowship or for a job, do have a mock interview with people who are going to be really tough on you. And if you can possibly get Jamie Ross John in the room, do. It makes all the difference. He is really horrible. And of course, he's somebody whose comments are right to the point. So he has helped us with program grants and all sorts of things that are just fabulously useful. I think also, think about getting involved, and so getting involved with ASI and ASMR. I know these are difficult things if you have a lot of other responsibilities, and so you have to really titrate this stuff, but when you have the chance, get some involvement. Of course, come to these meetings, but get involved in other ways as well, if you can, because again, the networking opportunities are great. Wider peer group, broader perspective, lots of new skills, higher profile, and good fun too. But there are times in your life when you probably have to choose very carefully about what you get involved in outside your actual research. I mean, that's clearly a difficult issue, and everybody has to think through strategically how they spend their time. That balance between focusing on the research in your own lab or whatever you're doing, and being involved in other things that will give you benefits in other ways and open up new opportunities. So that means understanding your own drivers, understanding the trade-offs you're making in your life. And if those trade-offs are difficult, at least you have to have a clear idea of why you're making those decisions, because you will want to go back and think, why am I doing this? and it's good to remember that you actually made a rational decision about that at some point. And then I think there's the point that I've been to at a couple of times in my life of thinking about, well, what next? Am I doing the best thing I can with what talents I have, and what do I want in the future? And I think at that stage, it's really important to think very deeply about what's most important to you in your own life, in your own research. If that's what you want to continue, you need to explore, talk to people about what the opportunities are. And then if the answer is you really should move, then just do it. And it takes, sometimes you just have to close your eyes and jump. It's a really hard decision to move away from something that you've done and loved doing and been incredibly committed to, as everybody in this room probably is to their research career. But sometimes it's right to change, and then really it's just better to do it because it's an incredibly exciting ride on the long winding road. I also recommend against complaining. And we all have things that we worry about and think have held us back, and we need to talk about those from time to time, but I think it's very important not to be somebody who complains, because life isn't fair, we know that. We don't always get the rewards we expect or think or even deserve from working very hard, but really in the end it's very important to just understand the opportunities that we have and be very positive about them. And then I think don't lose touch with the world and with your family and friends while you're working very hard on your career. All of these support structures are essential, and in the end that's what life is all about, having a rich life that goes beyond what one does in the lab. Everybody's idea of life-work balance is different, and I think for some of us, having a lot of work in our lives is actually good life-work balance, because that's how we like it. We don't want to just do a bit of work on the side. It's really our main driver, and we have to understand that and respect it in others. But everybody has their own balance, which might change at different times of their lives, but need to understand the choice that you're making. We also, I think, all will know that not all of our friends and family and partners will understand the pressures on us. They won't always understand why we want to work late in the lab or have to work all week on a grant or a paper. And that just goes with the space. We've all been there. And finally, I think you have to enjoy yourself. Do the things that will make day-to-day life enjoyable beyond work, beyond all the immediate responsibilities of daily life. Read books if that's what works for you. Go hiking if that's what works for you. Play music if that's what works for you. But don't let it all go. Those things are an incredibly enriching part of life. And so that's my list of how-tos, only some of which I've succeeded in myself. And now, when I took the NHMRC job, I received two cards. And this was one of them. I hope you can read it. It says, "So, does anyone else feel that their needs aren't being met?" And I thought that was a very, very astute card to capture what it's like being CEO of NHMRC. But the other one I got, which was incidentally from the same people, was this. Now, I don't think I'm either of those people. I'm neither the person who's just going to shove you all off the cliff if we can't meet your needs, but neither am I a super person of any kind. And I think, but I have this one pinned up on my notice board above my desk at home, and it gives me great hope and spirit for the journey ahead. So thank you very much.